Thank you all for joining us. Without further ado, Herbie J.
Yay!
Well, I do like that lighting. Yeah.
It's great.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Throwback Thursdays, our second season, which is happening because our first season was so successful. Thank you to Diane for igniting the program over the summer with Have a Nice Hand. And for Burbank Barnes & Noble, which is my favorite cozy Barnes & Noble on this side of the hill. This is a co-presentation of the Classic TV Preservation Society. This is a nonprofit organization that I formed formally about 4 years ago, but I started with my Classic TV seminars to schools, colleges, community centers, and senior centers when I was caring for my parents. And a good chunk of my life in my prime years, I did kind of dedicate to them, and I have not regretted it since. They changed my life, they didn't really have anything, and I made sure that in their later years that they were as comfortable as they could be. And in caring for them, I became friends with their older friends and their seniors, and that's where I learned the more important priorities of life. And essentially that whole experience led to the Classic TV Preservation Society. Now, my favorite TV show is Bewitched. As you know, I wrote a few books about the show, and then I did a biography on Elizabeth Montgomery, and then I did an encyclopedia. She was a very charitable individual. She used her public persona for the betterment of the community of the world, not just in Los Angeles or in this country. She always wanted to take her position and try to somehow use it so that others would benefit from it, whether it was in a personal way on the set or whether it was in a large way. And so when I finally interviewed her, and she did not give interviews, she wanted to leave. She was very hurt in many ways by the press. And you know, she grew up as the child of Robert Montgomery and Elizabeth Allen, who were very, very prestigious actors at the time in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. And she just saw what the press did to their lives. So she was very private. So it was kind of miraculous that she opened up to me and she trusted me. Anyway, the point is that who she was inspired me along with my parents. And what I try to do with this program is to bring in particular people, celebrities, who are authors and who also use their public persona for the betterment of the world community as well. And not just to be TV stars, and not just to be film stars, and not just to be music stars. They realize that they're gifted, and that the part of their gift is their ability to communicate. And so that is what's gonna bring us to our special guest this evening, who I will introduce in just one moment. Hi, welcome back. To Throwback Thursdays. My first and only guest tonight. I really like it when I just have one guest so we can focus exactly on what that person brings to the world of entertainment and to the world in general. So my first and only guest is really an incredible person. Whatever classic TV show that you can think of, she has somehow been a part of it, whether on camera or behind the scenes. I remember seeing her on the Carol Burnett Show, which I think was one of her first appearances in the first season, I believe, of the Carol Burnett Show. And she is just a lovely human being, so talented in so many different ways. She's been a singer, a songwriter, an actress, best known on television during the daytime for Days of Our Lives. And she's written a book. And that's gonna be the focus of today. So, without further ado, the one and only Gloria Loring.
Yay!
I love it. This is fun. I like it. I'm very casual. Can you tell? I've got my phone there, but I turned off the ringer so it won't bother us.
Well, you know, right away, what I love about
you. And I've not written one book. This is my seventh book, actually.
Oh, for the love of heaven.
No, I know, but you know what? Other ones were all, some of them were fundraisers for the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation. Mm-hmm. Two of them raised $1 million for diabetes research. And that, I know, wasn't that amazing? It wasn't just me. It was a lot of, you know, a lot of us. But it was kind of, it came to me as an idea. Because somebody asked me for, we're in the cookbook section. Somebody asked me for recipe for a celebrity cookbook. And then when I was on Days of Our Lives, when I first joined, and in the makeup room, I noticed that people were trading recipes. The actors were trading recipes. Oh, I've got this great, and you just put everything in the pan, and you 350, and you put it in the oven. And I thought, well, I bet the fans would love this. And my son had been diagnosed with diabetes a year before. And actually, this story is the first story and chapter of my book, which is about putting together this Days of Our Lives celebrity cookbook and getting everything ready. And 10 months later, I had everything ready to go, except I had no money to print the copies that I needed to print. And I needed $40,000 to print 50,000 copies. And I had asked, I'd done presentations, I talked to all kinds of people, and I was just out of ideas. But I kept thinking, you know, I can't have done all this work and come all this way for it not something not to happen. And what happened was, it was a Friday, I went in Days of Our Lives, I'd finished my day and I was first up, which meant I finished early, and I drove to the airport and I caught a plane to Houston to play in the Jack Benny Memorial Tennis Classic, because Jack Benny had had diabetes, so it was for juvenile diabetes. So the next night, after playing tennis all day with the paying clients, patrons, I sang a couple songs. I came down off the stage, and there was a man sitting right there at the bottom of the stage waiting for me. And I said, hi. And he said, hi, do you remember me? And I thought, well, I said, you do look familiar. And he said, I'm Ben Rogers from Beaumont, Texas. And I went, I remember you. I flew on your plane with Bob Hope. We went for a big golf thing in Cleveland. And I hear a little voice in my head say, tell him about the cookbook. And I'm thinking, who was that? But I kept talking, and then I hear again, I kind of hear, tell him about the cookbook. I get this prompting, this inner prompting. And finally, he said, your son has diabetes. I said, yes. And actually, I've created this cookbook, this Days of Our Lives celebrity cookbook. And, you know, I think we've got 10 million daily viewers, and I really think it could be a success. I think people would want it, and we're going to give it away in exchange for a minimum $10 donation. And he said, that sounds like a great idea. And I said, yeah, the only thing is, we don't have any money to print the books. And he said, well, how much do you need? And I said, well, I need $40,000. And he said, well, hell, girl. He said, I'll give you 10. Come on, let's go out in the lobby. I got some friends here tonight. This is Texas.
Nice.
By the end of the night, I had $17,500 committed. After trying for almost a year, within 4 weeks, I had $42,500. We printed 50,000 copies. We sold out. We printed another 50,000, and we raised $1 million for diabetes research. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? Just when you thought it could, nothing could change, and that story stayed with me all those years, because when I was talking with someone like yourself, an interviewer, and he said, "Well, that's an amazing story," I said, "I know. Can you believe that coincidence? Isn't that crazy?" And he said, "Well, yeah, but you know, coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous." And I said, whoa, wait a minute, say that again. Coincidence is what? God's way of what? Wait, I gotta write that down. Coincidence is God's way of what? Remaining anonymous. What does that mean? Wow. It's so cool. It sounds smart, doesn't it? Well, it's from Albert Einstein. Come on. If you're gonna borrow a title, borrow from somebody smart, okay? So this stayed with me all those years. And I, you know, I was on Days of Our Lives, and then other thing that I went through a divorce. I was married to Alan Thick, Robin Thick. Yes, I am. Hashtag Robin Thick's mom. Yes, I am. Mm-hmm. And I used to be Gloria Loring. Now I'm hashtag Robin Thick's mom. Anyway, but I was with Alan. We got divorced. All these things were happening. And now I started to notice, because I had this idea, coincidence is God's way. What does that mean? How does that work? And I started to see that very often, just when I needed it, something, someone, some inspiration would show up and help me to the next stage. Chapter 3 is about the letters that came to me from a woman in Lincoln, Nebraska, who I had not met until I was there doing an autograph session with the Days of Our Lives celebrity cookbook for a juvenile diabetes event. And that afternoon we did something like this. And she came up in the line and she said, I have a daughter who has epilepsy, so I really understand what you're going through with a child with chronic illness. And I just want you to know you're not alone. I understand. And she gave me a letter. And ever since my son had been diagnosed, there were people who commiserated, but the letter that she wrote me, I still have. I have all her letters. Was so enormously compassionate and inspiring that I just wound up sobbing. I didn't know that there could be somebody that kind. I mean, I've met kind people, but this was an and I didn't even know her, you know? And so I put the letter aside. I thought, isn't she wonderful? And about 6 weeks later, I got another letter from her, and she said, I don't know if I told you, but I pray a lot every morning, and I'm getting messages for you. And she said, I hope this isn't, you know, invasive in any way, here's the letter that I got. And this letter was, dear daughter, I'm putting you on a new road. No one in the world knew that I was separating from my husband. And this letter arrived saying, you are not alone. I am putting you on a new road. This is chapter 3. That's just like one chapter. These letters arrived for 2.5 years, about every 6, 8, 10 weeks, something like that. They started when I decided to separate. They ended when my divorce became final. And I asked her years later, when I started writing this book, I said, you know, I realize I'm so remiss in this. I never asked you, how did you start to write these letters to me? And why? How did that all come about? And she told me this extraordinary story about she was driving to her Bible study class on a Wednesday night. And she said, all of a sudden, it was as if I stepped out of time and space, and I pulled the car over, and I heard a voice say, you must tell Gloria that she is not alone and that she is loved. And she said, I started to argue with the voice and said, I don't know anybody named Gloria, except that actress on Days of Our Lives. And I don't know, I'm in Lincoln, Nebraska. How in the world will I ever see her or get to talk to her? If I write her a letter, she'll think I'm a Looney Tune. She really said Looney Tune. And the voice said, wait and see. And that night, she went to her Bible study, and they always had a little quiet kind of Quaker time at the end when they'd have a silence, and then if anybody felt prompted, and they were in their silent time after their discussion, and suddenly one of the women said, I don't know why, but I'm being prompted to share that I saw in the newspaper today that Gloria Loring is going to be here on Saturday signing her cookbook. And she heard a voice in her say, there it is. And that's how she wound up in front of me. Isn't that amazing? Wow. Isn't that amazing? Just when I most need it. And I don't think I'm special. I think these things happen to us. But if we don't have a context.
Or a level of awareness.
A level of awareness. We have to have a big, I think it expanded my vision that there is goodness in the universe, and whatever you want to call it, you can call it Yahweh, you can call it God, you can call it Buddha, whatever you want to call it, or call it nothing at all, it still exists. There is a connectedness between us and goodness and difficulty, by the way, which I also deal with in the book. But there is a connectedness, and we play our role in bringing that into our lives by what we think and feel and focus on, and sometimes we attract people who are the best bad guy. You know, like when you see like Humphrey Bogart or somebody in there, or Jack Nicholson, oh my God, he was the best bad guy in that movie. And haven't we all had somebody in our lives who's like the best bad guy, was so miserable, kicked my butt all over town, and I finally said, I am not having this anymore. I am going to grow up or step out or change my ways. I will never have a relationship like this again. You know, I mean, those are the people that we attract because they see our vulnerability. But my sister actually, as this book was being prepared for printing, my sister was in her last months of, she was dying. And she never got to read the book, but we were talking, I was telling her I was rewriting, and she just didn't have the energy. And, but she said, but, you know, when the good things come, I understand that, but, you know, she had cancer. And she said, but what about when the bad things, when the hard things come? Is that, are we attracting that? And I said, don't go there. It's not that. Things happen. We don't know why. We don't even know why the good comes into our lives sometimes. But what we can ask, and I think this is really key, is what is this asking of me? what is this asking of me? What is this person who's such a jerk? Patience? Empowerment on my own part? Excuse me, no, I am not going to be treated like that.
Right.
Compassion? You look like you're having a really hard day. I see, I've done that with people who are real cranky, like a checkout lady or something, and you see them, and sometimes you'll hear people like, you're such a bitch. I mean, I hate that word. Ooh. But anyway, you know what I mean. I just judge. And I will look at that person, this is an unhappy person.
Right.
And so I will, as I go up to them out and they're checking things, I say, you look like you're having a tough day. And invariably, they will turn and say, yeah.
Well, it's not a good day.
Yeah, it's my sister's sick. My child went to the, you know, something happened. My mother, whatever, something happened. And so what this idea of this coincidence being the goodness with a capital G that connects us is that everywhere we go, we can use anything that is good or that doesn't seem good for the good by looking at, what is this asking me? And it's asking us to become more than we have been. It's asking more patience. It's asking more goodness, more compassion, more kindness, you know, something like that. And that's what the book is about. And I've had people say to me that they've read it 6 and 7 times and they keep it because there's so much in it. Even though it's just my stories and a lot of wisdom that I gleaned, because it took me 10 years to write. I kept saying, who's going to want to get a book by Gloria Loring that talks about coincidence and God, for heaven's sakes? But
it sounds like a TV movie for sure. I mean,
well, it's pretty, you know, I think every one of us has a life that could, with the right writer and crew, could make a TV movie. But there is so much, and I find even now, everything that comes into my life that challenges me in any way, is asking me to become more, asking me to step up, to change my ways, to find a new way of thinking, a new way of being, whatever.
So you think that happens to all of us, wherever we go, each of us?
Yeah. Yeah. You get somebody who just, here's the thing that I see. The minute somebody really pisses me off, I mean really like, I realize that they are exhibiting some quality that I don't like about myself.
It's the truth. That's absolutely
that
the truth.
Wonderful thing somebody told me once, where when you point a finger at somebody else, you have 3 fingers pointing back at you.
Wow.
Oh, look at him. He's, oh, yeah. And I find it to be true. Every time I want to just somebody, I go, oh, I've done that. I have done that, and I probably still do,
Now you're evolved in that way, though. I mean, most people in general are not that mindful. So how do you get to be mindful? If you don't think there's any issue, if you think it's the other person.
I think you have to be suffering so much that you'll do whatever it takes to not suffer anymore. I grew up in a family with alcoholism. I talk about that. I also talk in chapter 8 and 9 about an event that happened that we would call inappropriate sexualized contact with my father when he was very drunk, that profoundly affected me. And I think that I had so much deep trauma stuff sitting in there. My niece, who's many years younger than me, but had 2 alcoholic parents, and her mother used to beat the crap out of her and punch her in the face and stuff like, I mean, just... And she's been, we've been in relationship for 10 years now. She has a wonderful 8-year-old boy. And she said, how do you stay so stable? How do you stay, nothing hardly ever. I said, honey, it's taken 25 years of meditation and practice and spiritual work and reading and, you know, contemplation. I mean, every time anything happens that disturbs me, that rocks me, I go to my meditation place and I sit and figure it out. What is this about? What is this about, Gloria?
What about as an artist? Do you believe that the challenges that you've had have contributed to your art as an actress, as a performer, as a songwriter? Certainly directly, obviously, you wrote a book because of it. But
yeah.
I mean, on some, you know, earthy level, do you feel that had these things not happened in your life that you would be a lesser artist or a lesser person?
I don't know. I there are people with really great childhoods who are fabulous artists. I mean, there is that myth that, you know, we have to be Picasso and destroy lives everywhere in order to be a great, great artist. And I don't think that's true. I think each of us has had hurts. That I don't think there's hardly anyone who's escaped. I have a person of my darling friend Debra, Miss Debra from Bristol, Tennessee. We call her the Bristol Pistol. She's had diabetes for 50 years. She's in fabulous health. She had the most wonderful mother and father. Lived with her mother and father until they both passed. I mean, she just always lived in Bristol, and there was never a reason to move out. But Miss Debra, when she came home from the hospital when she was 9, and she was like, okay, I'm back, you know, I have diabetes, but I'm taking shots, and, you know, I'm going to be great, and Mom and Dad are helping me, and none of the people on the block would let their children play with her anymore. And she internalized this as, I'm not healthy, I'm not good enough anymore. And it took many years before she could finally realize what that had done to her. And she's now finally letting go of that. Because she used to get, smoke would come out of her ears practically. Just somebody, you know, teased her about her diabetes. Because mm-hmm. that was her vulnerable spot. Mm-hmm. But we've been really good friends now for 17 years. And we've talked about all these practices. And she's a meditator now. And, you know, the thing about meditation is, first of all, it actually changes your brain. And if you've had abuse as a child, they have shown that when you've been abused as a child, there are changes that go on in the brain. The amygdala gets bigger. You become more sensitized. PTSD, you know, when people have had this enormous trauma, stuff gets triggered really quickly. So what you can do, there's actually a book called Train Your Mind, Change Your Brain. It's about some people working with the Dalai Lama. And they're actually able to, now that they have the brain scans, you know, show that people who meditate regularly actually change the structure of the brain. And for a long time we thought, oh, it's done, you know, after you're 12 or whatever. No. It is plastic for your whole life. Less so than when you're 12, but it still can change. And so what happens is, as you practice peace, what you're doing is practicing peace. I had an interesting experience when I was in my early years. I had come back from the ashram and I had this great meditation experience, and I went in, I lit my little candle, and I had my little flowers and pictures of my family there, and I sat down and I'm like, okay, breathe. And the birds are singing, and it's a perfect morning, and like, bills are paid, my kids and I are getting along, everything's fine. And my mind scans my life until it finds the one thing that is unresolved. And I start to wrestle, how could she, and she didn't pay me back that money, and she said, and I went, wait, Gloria. See, I had something to compare it to. I went, stop. Put it down. Mm-hmm. I'm going to call her. I'm just going to... And there it went again. And I suddenly got it. I went, oh, I have a negative mind. You couldn't have told me that, because I'm a very positive person. But my mind wanted to seek out the one thing that wasn't working. Now, there are good reasons for this. The reasons we go toward the... By the way, I'm a certified yoga instructor, and I've taught yoga philosophy, and also you're going to get a little dose of this stuff. The reason is because we really do need to watch for the danger zones in our, you know, the tiger in the jungle, the, you know, the flesh-eating dinosaur, whatever. We need to have that ability to watch. What happens is we get overstimulated to the bad. I mean, we know that people who watch television all the time, especially with a lot of stuff that's going on now, or at any time, in World War II, Korean War, any Vietnam, you can watch any of that stuff. There's always corruption and war and dying, and if you watch that all the time, you will start to feel that the world is a very dangerous place, when in actuality, right now, there is less armed conflict going on in the world than at any time in the history of the world. Huh? But ISIS and decapitations and, but in truth, but we get it brought into our, imagine if you lived with, for the people in Syria, yeah, but I live in Lake Arrowhead. Nobody's getting decapitated in Lake Arrowhead, you know? Your God, thank you. But so it depends on where we're putting our attention. So you talk about being mindful. It depends on where we're putting our attention. And we tend to find what we look for. We tend to find what we look for.
So the trauma of your childhood abuse, you know, was happening, and it actually formed you physically, psychologically. And then what you're saying is meditation can fix that and do the reverse.
It can change the brain. It because we start to become, just like becoming aware of my tendency to look at the negative, and all, the negative about myself. I mean, I've developed a whole way of teaching this stuff, but we always can change. We can change until the last minute. You know, if we're on a tendency and we're going down a path, and we say, I don't like the way I'm living. I don't like the way I'm feeling. I don't like the way the biggest thing is to become aware. What are you thinking? What are you thinking? But the problem is, the difficulty is sometimes the thoughts are subterranean. They're really deep down.
Right, right.
They're, you know, and there's an acting technique called hold it lines. And a hold it line is an improvisational technique that, what's her name? Oh, fabulous teacher. And she taught, I learned it from Stephen Book, an acting coach. But the idea is you take a line that's always, no, another one, but I'll think of it in a minute. You take a line because in a script, a character embodies certain understandings, certain life messages. We call them personal myths in psychology, okay? And you will hear, I'll give you a great one. Remember The Rainmaker?
Yep.
Remember
okay, sure.
Burt Lancaster, right? Burt Lancaster. And Katharine
Hepburn.
Hepburn, yes, thank you, Katharine Hepburn. I heard that little voice and I got disturbed. I remember. Katharine Hepburn feels she's playing and she's with him. And she's saying her hold it line, her personal idea about herself that she holds as an absolute truth is, well, I'm not pretty. I think that's what she says, I'm not pretty. And he said, but you are pretty. And she said, oh no, I'm not. And what did I'm not pretty mean? Well, to her family and in her community, I'm not pretty is no man's gonna want me. I'm gonna be alone the rest of my life. No one's gonna wanna marry me. I'm gonna just be here to serve. I'm here to serve my dad and my brothers, and you know, I have no life of my own. My life is, I just have to do whatever everybody else wants. I have no life of my own. And you see this gorgeous shift from the hold it line that she has to the expansion of her being when he says, but you are pretty. You're very pretty. And you see her go from, no, I'm not pretty, to, you see her start to blossom like a flower. In that time when she is given an expansion on this idea that she holds about herself. Well, that's what acting is. What do we do with acting? We start with people with a problem, and when it's a really great script, we see that person grow and expand and change, and hopefully by the end of it, some great shift has taken place that gets us excited, you know, that warms our hearts or changes us in some way, some realization. And that's what happens. And I suddenly got it when I took this acting class with Stephen Book for 2 years. And I realized, I caught myself saying one day, nothing I do is good enough. Nothing I do is good enough. Nothing. Nothing. And I thought, oh my God, that sounds like a hold it line. I was still crying, but there was another part of me that was saying, that sounds just like a hold it line. Because the hold it line is an always or never line. It's always or never because it was formed in childhood. Children don't know in the middle. They know always or never. Everything is, you know, omnipotent about them. Like you said, they say to you something like, you never take me for ice cream. And you say, I took you yesterday, but you never take me today. You know, it's always or never. Well, for children, it's an absolute. So when we hear ourselves in a time of usually rage or great grief saying something that's an always or never statement, that's a personal myth that we hold about ourselves. Mm. And I found out, once I learned it's a combination of acting and yoga psychology, etc., when I started to put these things together, I found, and I started listening to myself, and I found out I have some, nothing I do is good enough, big hold it line. No one understands me. My way of solving that was I talked louder and longer. If you didn't understand me, I'd make sure you could understand me. Right? And another one I found was, somebody always spoils my fun. And I don't know where that came from. But it would really bother me if I wanted to do something and somebody would tromp on it. Hmm. Yeah, so I don't know if maybe that was from living with an alcoholic and, you know, I would be happy and then something, pots and pans would start to fly or, you know, something like that.
So do you think everyone should take an acting class and a yoga class? I think they should. Whether you want to be an actor or not, right?
An acting class, an improv class is really great because you have to wing it. You just have to be up there. And the greatest thing about it is you have to say yes. Oh, that's a fabulous chicken on your head. Yes, I know. I just bought him yesterday, and he has a cousin. And I'm going to pick the cousin up tomorrow. And you just play along. You just say yes and. Yes, and isn't he pretty? I love the red feathers on top. He's just, you know, and you just play along. But isn't that what kids do? They sure. They play along. Mm-hmm. And we lose that. We want to refute. We want to... We know it, but it's reality. But no, come on, play. Right. You know, so.
Well, let's talk a little bit about, you know, your writing for the classic TV themes. And how you also have a show that you include many classic TV themes.
Well, I did. We did do. We put that show together. And we, my darling partner passed last year. And we didn't get it up on its feet in the way we wanted to. We had it. It was extraordinary. It was called TV Tunes, and we had it one night at the Music Box that was in Hollywood, and people just said, oh my God, this is the best show. You're not going to be here tomorrow? We want to come back. But she got sick, and then my sister got sick, and lots of stuff. So, is that an earthquake?
No, it's the gym upstairs.
Okay. We had one the other morning in Lake Arrowhead, I felt. Did you feel it down here?
No.
No, but I heard that.
It was strange. But yeah, that was really fun. Yeah.
Why do you think people love those themes so much? What is it?
They grew up with them. You take the good, you take the bad, you take them both, and there you have the facts of life. The facts of life. There you go.
Dang it, there she go. The facts of life. She wrote that.
I co-wrote it. Got to give Alan some credit. Come on.
And you also did.
And I sang it. That was my voice. Right. You heard all these. Don't you love that mailbox money? Oh, honey, let me tell you.
Yeah,
I still get checks for Different Strokes and Facts of Life. Yay!
But not Hello, Larry.
I didn't write Hello, Larry.
Oh, you didn't write it.
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
Okay.
Alan was the big TV theme writer. He started in Canada writing for the CBC. The CBC, eh? Anyway. we was... Remember, you know, Danny Mann? Danny Mann. Well, he's a comedian, comic writer, et cetera, et cetera. Danny Mann, remember the movie Babe? He was the rooster. Oh. The rooster... In Bay, it was always... And he was at the house one night, this many years ago, and they were having a writing session, and and I came in to bring them coffee or something, and they started in on, he says, you work for the CBC, eh? And then Alan said, yep, I'm a CPA with the CBC, eh? And then they said, you got a little drinking problem, so you joined the AA, eh? and of course... The more they did, the funnier it got. So that's where that came from, the CBC, eh? But yes, classic. I think people just love them because they take them back. And everybody knows them. That night we did TV Tunes, everybody sang along. 10-year-olds. Patricia Neal was there that night, 82 years old. She was singing along with all the theme songs. It was amazing. It was fabulous.
And they don't have any theme songs. We talked about that last
I know. Week. They go right into the next thing. There's almost no theme music at all anymore. Well, you see, but you have 729 channels to choose from. Before, you had three. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they could... The theme music was a way to pull you in. Now right. They don't want to lose you.
Yeah.
They want to show a grisly murder so you get interested, you know.
Right. Well, let's open the floor up a little bit here.
Yes.
Okay, bump up the lights.
Yeah, pump up the lights.
All right, does anybody have a question? Yes.
Well, it's not really a question. It's more of a statement about the theme music.
Yes.
Because I was sitting there
looking, even though there are 720-some-odd channels, looking for something to watch, and the theme music of Facts of Life came on, and I watched that. I mean, with all the shows that are on, it was a repeat, and I mean, my thumb was sore from the remote of channel surfing. But
I go to TV Land every time.
TV Land
or Nick at Night.
Antenna TV.
I don't know if I can end.
I don't watch. There are very few channels I watch because it's, you know, a lot of TLC. I watch some of that stuff, but,
well, let's
but HGTV is my favorite.
Well, you also made
in 30 minutes or 60 minutes, somebody gets a new home. Oh, I love that.
The international version.
Yes.
What were some of your favorite classic TV? You did Murder, She Wrote.
I did that. Right. I did that with Angela. Yeah, that was fun to work with her.
What are your memories of it in particular?
Just that she was so gracious. Yeah. I mean, you know, you come in and you work very fast, so you don't get a lot of time to hang out or anything like that. Days of Our Lives, doing Days of Our Lives for all those years, was 6.5 years, was a lot of fun. I mean, that was crazy. You know, we had the time, my character's supposed to be very wealthy, so I had a fur coat, so I brought this fur coat in, and one of the other actresses, I don't remember who, but we loved to do anything to just harass Teo Penglis, because he was so easy to harass. So I put the mink coat on over nothing. And she went, she opened the door, and he turned around, and I went, woohoo! And just we used to do crazy stuff. Cool. And Wayne Northrup tied Deidre Hall into her room. He tied the doorknob to the doorknob across, and they called her to the stage, and she couldn't get out.
You have to do those things on a soap because there's so much work to do. Yeah. Constant lines. It's amazing. What was your system or procedure for memorizing lines?
I'm very blessed. I have a photographic memory. So even if I had 30 or 40 pages a day, if it was well written, I could start that morning and know it by the time we taped. But we had I would read it the day before, but I had two little children at home. And I got home at 6 or 7 o'clock and put them to bed at 8:30. And by 9, I had to get up at 5. So by 9 o'clock, I was like this, okay, just read through the script, mark your lines, and, you know, and then I was out. So I would get up the next morning and I'd start with script in hand. And then what happens though is, you see, as long as it's not too complex, sometimes this stuff was really complex, but once you know that, you know, I start here and I say, I don't know why you didn't tell me about this before. And then, you know, you turn and you walk over here. So you get it in your body that you say this line here, and now you walk and you turn. And then, of course, you stare into space, which is so dumb, mm-hmm. but you do. So you kind of get it in your body, and you have all day to know it. But that's what happens with auditions, is you get a scene or some scenes, and you have the script in front of you, but basically you have to know them and be ready to perform them. So you just learn how to do that. But we did have some people, Michael Ansara, do you remember?
Barbara Eden.
No, was it Cochise? No, what was the?
Yeah,
Cochise, yeah. One wonderful gentleman. And he came on and he did like a little cameo or something one day. He could not figure it out. It freaked him out with the three camera, because he was used to one camera. But we did, it all worked so fast that you have three cameras. Well, like here, we have three cameras. And you turned here, and then you turned here, and you turned here. Okay, scene done. And it was just such a different way of working for him. So, you know, when you learn how to do that on a soap opera, you learn to work really fast.
Yeah, some of the best training ever for the industry.
Oh, there are a lot of wonderful actors who've come out of it, and a lot of wonderful actors who've stayed in soap opera too. Yeah, people used to say, why did you leave Days of Our Lives? I said, because they shot me every 2 years, whether I needed it or not. I just couldn't stay and get shot again. Just couldn't. I just had to get out of there.
yes, Harry.
Anything else?
Did you ever have any input on where your character was going on the soap?
I did once. Well, because of my son having diabetes, they decided to write in a storyline where my little girl, Noelle, would get diabetes. And so we could actually explain to people what it is. I got the most heartrending letter from a mother who said, please, you have to stop this diabetes storyline. She said, my daughter got diabetes, and we didn't know, we thought she had the flu, and we took her to the emergency room, and we were sitting in the emergency room waiting for her to be taken in, admitted, and she died. You know, what do you say? But hopefully the information that we gave was, we got noted, you know, letters from a lot of people saying, thank you so much. I didn't know that diabetes was so serious. I didn't know what it entailed. Thank you for educating. You know, so, you know, but that's the position you're in. And I remember when my character slept with Don Craig. Well, yeah, my character slept, not me, Don. Jen Allen. Don Craig. And I got a letter from a lady. She said, I will never give any money for diabetes research because you slept with Don. I went, I didn't sleep with Don. And I wanted to do that great line from Tootsie. He's like, I don't write this shit. You know? But people sometimes think you are
that character.
You are.
Well, especially it was for 6 years every day. So.
Yeah, I was on about 2-3 times a week for 6.5 years. And my character with Neil, Joe Gallison, who was a wonderful actor, he was great. I learned so much from working with him. He always completely gave me his eyes, complete commitment to the scene. He was ferocious. I loved working with him. And
would you ever go back and do a guest spot or anything?
They haven't asked me in all these years. I don't think they're going to. So, you know, it was great. I loved it.
Well, they may now when they see that.
Yeah, oh, sure. Oh, sure.
Yes, more questions, please.
Yes, sir.
Do you prefer singing or...
It's going to happen.
The thing that I do most naturally is sing. You know, acting is a form of music. It is a form of communication, but for me to be able to use my voice like that is just really, really sweet.
Well, let's use that voice now. What do you say?
Oh, okay, we have to see if this is going to work.
Okay, when we come back, Gloria's going to say.
When we come back, I'm Chiquita Banana.
That's the door.
All right, so this is when I was on Days of Our Lives, Liz was a singer. And what now?
Your character.
My character, Liz. And this was a song that Liz sang, and let's see if this works.
Okay, I'm gonna step over here. Ladies and gentlemen, Gloria Loring.
Can you hear that?
Yes.
Yeah, let's see if it works. I don't know. Oh my God. I celebrate my love for you. It seems the natural thing to do. Tonight, no one's gonna find us. We'll leave the world behind us when I make love to you. Tonight I celebrate my love for you, and hope that deep inside you'll feel it too. Tonight our spirits will be climbing to a sky lit up with diamonds when I make love to you. Tonight, I celebrate my love for you, and the midnight sun is gonna come shining through. Tonight, there'll be no distance between us. What I want most to do is to get close to you. Tonight celebrate my love for you. And soon this old world will feel brand new. Tonight we will both discover how friends turn into lovers when I make love to you tonight. It's my friend Troy Dexter. Tonight there'll be no distance between us. What I want most to do is to get close to you. Tonight I celebrate my love for you. Tonight I celebrate my love for you.
Thank you. Gosh, that was so wonderful. Another hand, please. That was so beautiful. I have one more. Wait a minute. I have one more
we could do. But are you going to take one of your breaks? Do I have to sing Chiquita Banana again?
I think we can just go right into it. So, ladies and gentlemen.
I wish I were an Oscar Mayer wiener.
Are we ready to go? One more time.
Okay, so this is, yeah, my son. I can sing. This is actually a duet that we do.
Oh, cool.
That is on, it's on my, I brought music if you want. This is sort of my, this is called a playlist.
Okay.
And this is all my favorite songs I've recorded in the last 15 years or so. And this has this duet on it. And then the Christmas album has the duet on it. That's me in the red dress. I look good in red.
You look good in anything.
And then every chapter of the book has a song associated with it. And all the songs are on this CD.
Perfect.
And it's called Turn the Page. So, all right, now, let me get this.
Ready?
Let's see if I can do this sitting down.
Gloria Loring.
Okay, Gloria Loring. Can you hear the music well enough?
Yes.
Is it? Oh, it goes out there. Cool. Sounds pretty good, isn't it amazing? Crazy how easy this is. I pray you'll be all right and watch us where we go and help us to be wise in times when we don't know. Oh, let this be our prayer when we lose our way. Lead us to a place, guide us with your grace, to a place where we'll be safe. I pray we'll find your light
and hold it in our hearts.
And hold it in our hearts.
The stars go out each night.
Ooh.
Remind us where you are.
Remind us where you are.
Let this be. Fill our day.
When shadows fill our day, lead us to a place, guide us with your grace, to a place where we'll be safe.
A world where pain and sorrow will be ended, and every heart that's broken will be mended, and we'll remember we are all God's children, reaching out to touch you, reaching to the sky. We ask that life be kind, and watch us as we grow. We hope each soul will find another soul to love. Let this be our prayer, just like every child needs to find a place. Guide us with your grace to a place where we'll be safe.
Lead us to a place.
Guide us with your grace to a place where we'll be safe.
I know. That, oh, it gets a lot of people. Trust me. You're
no, that song, yeah. That's one of my songs. Yeah. Of course, no coincidence.
I really don't know what to say. I mean, just an amazing human being, an amazing talent. You do everything that the Classic TV Preservation Society seeks to represent, and you've brought so much joy to the world, like so many wonderful and talented actresses and actors, but you stand out because of your heart and your generosity that is just everywhere present. So thank you.
My pleasure to be here. Thanks, everybody.
See you next week. Thank you, Barnes & Noble. Thank you, Michael, Uncle Polly, Julie. God bless you all.
Thank you, everybody. This is called the Monster Clarity, it's called.
Amazing.
It's pretty good for this little tiny thing.
Yeah.
Well, I brought my $1,000 microphone, so that helps. Although we don't have EQ or anything, but it still works pretty well.
Good.
Okay, so let me find this. This is fun. I'll share this with you. Don't tell anyone.
And then you have to do a song with
me. No.
Then I have to... okay, now wait a minute. Where is it? Flickr. Okay, so I'm going to sing along with this. Because I haven't... I've got to make sure I actually know all the words. But this is a song that we're working on for a new recording project. Robin's on this too, singing backgrounds.
Suspense is round the corner. The trees have gone on trial. Uncertainty is sexy. Could that have been a smile? I can almost smell the leather, the scent of misty leaves. A dog kicks up some banter, begging for the sun's reprieve. Like winter into springtime, life will take a turn. Love will paint the colors and help our heart to learn. From when you least expect it, there's hope where there was none. choose what you become.
Choose what you
become. Season flips a quarter, and there's change in what you've done. A flicker of a shadow, and you choose what you become. After every darkness, there's bound to be a dawn. Just one foot, then the other. You just keep moving on. So when the days are shorter and warmth denies your face, keep searching for the sunrise and welcome its embrace. Like winter into springtime, life can take a turn. Love will paint the colors and help a heart to learn. But when you least expect it, there's hope where there was none. A flicker of a shadow, and you choose what you become. A season flips a quarter, there's change in what you've done. A flicker of a shadow, and you choose what you become. 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 Flicker of a shadow, what you become. There's change in what you've done. Flicker of a shadow, what you become. You choose what you become. You choose what you become. That I wrote that song based on a poem. I wrote that, yeah. Yeah, it's a it's really turned out good. But it's based on a poem that a friend of mine wrote at a time of great distress. And she was actually, I was going to call this album Songs from the Blue Room, because I have a bedroom that's all blue. And she was staying in there, and it was the fall, and the light was changing, and the leaves were dropping. And she wrote this poem about a flicker of a shadow, and you choose what you become. And I took all, so some of those lines are hers, but the song really, and Robin's backgrounds, aren't they gorgeous? They're so beautiful. Anyway, thank you for listening. That was fun.